This is CTP 33. Isn't that exciting?
It somehow? Is. That's my favorite number.
It's also my age. It's your age.
That's true.
And just, it's also, and it rhymes. Me. It also rhymes.
CTP 33?
CTP 33.
You should do that as your introduction.
Let's do this mess. Welcome to the Crooked Table Podcast. This is Rob.
And this is Kai.
And in this episode, we're going to be talking about Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children, which is just as long and cumbersome as its title. But we'll get to that in a second. First of all, I'd like to welcome Kai back to the podcast. Were you on the last one? I forget now. What episode was the last one we did?
Gosh, I don't remember.
I guess it was Sully. Oh, yeah, you were. You were on the last one. Welcome back again.
Thank you.
Sully was also very forgettable, but not as forgettable as Miss Peregrine. Again, we'll get to that. So I guess anything to report? Any news going on with you?
Well,
anything to share?
Well, if we're talking about what we've been watching or reading, as we normally do on these podcasts, my big thing, as you all probably know already, is I'm a big reader. And in fact, the night before the screening of Miss Peregrine, Home for Peculiar Children, I actually had finished the first book, and I have...
Okay, well, don't talk about that now.
Right. So that's what I read, and then... So I've just been reading a lot, and actually been doing book reviews for a nonprofit, so that gives me more reason to read, and I get free books, so I'm reading.
Where can people find that?
It's readerviews.com.
Okay.
Yes. Views for... It's V-I-E-W-S, not V-U-E-S.
Nobody spells views V-U-E-W-S or whatever you just said.
I don't know.
Did you say V-U-E-W-S? Because now you're really...
V-I-E-W-S?
No, I know, but you said V-U-E something. Did you say V-U-E-W?
No.
Because that makes even less sense.
I said V-U-E-S, not V-U-E-S. I don't know. Some people...
No, they don't. Okay. Nobody spells it that way. Not even in today's, like...
Not even to be
text
cute.
Text culture, where everybody's like, BRB, LOL,
not
BTW.
Not even to be cute and kitschy?
No, I don't think so.
Oh, okay.
if you're a millennial or older, whatever, and you type views that way just to be cute or funny, even though it's neither, that's up to you, I guess. But send me a tweet at Crooked Table, because I'd be curious to disagree with you on that. Well, hey, we can get into a Twitter argument. Let's go for it. So, no, but that's not all we've been watching and reading and stuff. Well, now we're recording this on October 1st. And so, happy belated International Podcast Day, first of all, from yesterday. Yesterday was International Podcast Day, September 30th. So, we've also been starting to watch Halloween movies already. We watched John Carpenter's Halloween, which is a classic. So let's get, and Kai had never seen it before, so I'm curious to hear what her thoughts are now that you've finally seen it. What was your, to start off the month of October talking about a scary movie, I feel like that's sort of fitting.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is with any older movie like that, especially a horror film, it's just, I already knew a lot of what the story was. Some of that was because of a movie like Scream that showed actual clips from the film. It's also just... knowing about the origin of Michael Myers. So there wasn't very many jump scares. There were actually, I think there was one jump scare for me. I don't even remember what part, but I'm actually not really even a very good horror watcher because I don't like it. It scares me. I don't like scary images. I don't like
That's kind of the intention though.
Right. But I don't like to feel scared. Like I like to go on a roller coaster and feel my stomach go up into my esophagus.
That's what a horror movie is, though. A good horror movie.
Right, but...
No?
I guess. But I don't know. I think more for me, it's not the jump scares. It's more what happens to me after the movie's over. When I go to sleep, where I'm like... Obviously, monsters, the supernatural kind, aren't real. But there's just this idea of monsters that could come get me.
Well, but Michael Myers Michael Myers is in this... Spoilers for a 40-year-old film almost, but Michael Myers is an escaped mental patient with a knife and who likes to strangle people. Right. So there's nothing supernatural about that.
Exactly. That's what I was also going to say is that he's not a supernatural. He's a monster in like a literal kind of way, a realistic kind of way.
Well, and the movie goes out of its way to depict him as a force of nature. I mean, I read something in the trivia that on IMDb, which, you know, we like to read after we watch movies, old or new, that John Carpenter is really wanted the character to not be relatable to the audience in any way, shape, or form. So that's why they wanted to sort of give you hints of what his backstory was, but not, you know, not delve so deeply into who is this guy, who is this guy, and how did he get to be this way, and why is he 15 years later feel this way about whatever, what are his motives, blah, blah, blah. So you're just like, whoa, this guy's just like a sociopathic killer, and just, you know, to keep him as vague as possible so he could function as the boogeyman, like the movie references. Right.
What about what it's also said in the trivia about how people commented John Carpenter about the fact that his face unmasked looked like a monster when it was just supposed to be Michael
It was just
Myers
the actress, apparently. It was just the actor's face, I guess.
Yeah, but it was a way of the perception of really looking at Michael Myers as a monster.
Right.
So, and that John Carpenter was really actually just surprised about how people can change their perception on somebody based on
context, basically.
Right.
Well, I mean, we right before we started recording, we were talking about this crazy thing with the clowns that's happening all over the place. And that's a perfect example. Apparently one of them got shot, I guess, was the news story that you just told me about. And it's, you know, that's another thing of context, in the context of, you know, it's a Halloween party or like Guavaween over here in Tampa, and people are just, you know, celebrating and being silly or whatever. You know, that then someone in a Halloween costume dressed as a clown is sort of a normal thing. But given the news stories that's been going on about this, and someone popping up on somebody else, then they got shot, it's like, well, in that context, then that it really is even scarier than, you know, clowns are to people normally without that kind of
right
setup.
Right, especially since it's been happening for months.
Yeah.
You know, this is, you know, if it was one, it's one thing if it started closer to Halloween. But this is, I think, been going on since July or August now. And
yeah. It feels like the next Purge movie should draw inspiration from this.
Yeah. Maybe it will.
The Purge Circus Town or something like that or whatever. Because a lot of people have been saying about how that film, which the most recent one, which made more money than... Because David Chan of the Slash Film Cast tweeted out about that it made more money than the newest films from Michael Bay, from Duncan Jones, from Steven Spielberg. The Purge Election Year made a lot of money.
Why?
Because people like that kind of thing, and because it resonates particularly now, because it's about an election and about a blonde woman running for office, trying to say about how she's going to, you know, get rid of the purge and like restore order and that kind of thing, and about this like sort of tyrannical ruler that she's challenging and all this other stuff. So it sounds very. So a lot of people are reading into it that it's parallel to the Trump and Clinton thing, and we're not going to get into politics, but I'm just making a point about how those movies have sort of become very timely in a way, and this would be a way for that new one to sort of tie in. But going back to Halloween, we're way off topic, but which is giving you a little glimpse into our private life. And just we're like, blah, 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 blah. What are we talking about? I don't know. 3 hours later, time to go to sleep. It's like 4 a.m. What did you think of Halloween? For the most part, giving that, yes, you knew it was a classic, and you knew some things about it going in, watching it, I guess, with fresh eyes, were you able to see, like, oh, okay, I get why this was a big deal, why this, like, sort of affected cinema so much? Or were you like whatever, it's a dude in a mask, who cares?
No, I understand. I mean, if we were alive during that time, and this was, like, the first of its kind, then I think we would have been blown away. Like, similar to what happened with Star Wars, but there's been 40 years
around the same time too, like the year before it was Star Wars.
It's been 40 years of history, so, and 40 years of spoilers. But I think that the way that it was filmed, it really it does show how horror films really came to be, and why a lot of horror films started to do the same thing: the point of view shots, the angles with the camera to give it more mystery and suspense.
The people that are the most sinful and drinking and smoking and having sex are the ones that die.
But that was actually another interesting thing in the trivia, was that John Carpenter said it had nothing to do with them having sex.
No, but people read into it.
Right.
And that became the thing that all horror movies were doing after that.
But what was really the story is that John Carpenter was trying to prove...
The slasher films, I should say, not horror movies, but...
Yeah, well, John Carpenter was trying to prove with those teenagers getting killed that were having sex, that they weren't aware of what was going on around them, compared to Lori, who wasn't trying to have sex and drink and stuff like that. And she was actually being a really good babysitter. She was able to stay alive because she was paying attention.
Right.
So, and that's actually a really good moral lesson for today, every day, is
Watch out for those killer clowns, because they could be anywhere, basically.
Yeah, pay attention to your surroundings. Be aware. And don't be oblivious to what's happening, because Michael Myers is a realistic monster. Those people do exist, and just be aware of things.
Yeah, so recommended by you.
Yes, I recommend
it. Even though most people have already seen this, but still, yes. If you haven't seen it,
multiple,
you've been putting it
off, multiple times.
Check it out. Yeah, well, yeah.
I did see Halloween H2O, though.
So did I. Yeah, like around the same time.
In theaters, yeah. And that was like...
I didn't see it in theaters, though. I saw it on VHS. Because we're dating ourselves here. Not Blu-ray, not DVD, not streaming. VHS.
But, yeah, I did see Halloween H2O, and I obviously knew that the original Halloween was much better than Halloween H2O. But, hey, that's...
We've already talked about probably watching Halloween 2 next when we can get our hands on it. Just because I've never seen it and I've wanted to, and I know that it sort of completes this initial story with Michael Myers and Laurie, and then, you know, before a season, it feels like season, but I was thinking, because the third one's called Halloween 3, Season of the Witch, that's why I was thinking season, before that one tried and failed to sort of shift gears on the franchise. But it's funny that we watched that recently, because actually a friend of mine posted on Facebook, oh, I picked up these two new horror t-shirts, it's Halloween and Texas Chainsaw Massacre. And I was like, oh, I watched both of those this week. That's weird.
Well, do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, that's where I was getting. So I watched that for the first time this week because, I don't know, I obviously it came out way before my time, and, you know, I was aware of it as a kid, but it was like, oh, that looks intense, I don't know. And it was just one that I always meant to go back to. But I guess I was sort of intimidated by, like, the reputation it had about being so shocking and so dark and so gritty and so, like, shot like a snuff film, sort of, and, like, so indie feel, like sort of how the original Evil Dead functions, even though it kind of gets unintentionally silly towards the latter half. But I finally decided, because, you know, I've been doing articles for Screen Rant and elsewhere, and I did one on belated horror sequels talking about Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2, and it just finally clicked in my head. I'm like, all right, I need to just break down and watch this original, because of all the, and I've told you this already, but, you know, of all the big horror, like, flagship franchises, the Freddy Krueger movies, or Nightmare on Elm Street movies, the Friday the 13th, the Halloween movies, and all these other ones, Child's Play, et cetera, Hellraiser, that's the only one that I haven't seen any of them. Not even the original classic, not any of the sequels. I haven't seen nothing from Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Just because I think at a certain point it didn't appeal to me, and I heard that the remake and the sequel to the remake and the prequel to the original or in the whatever they've been doing the last decade or so, I've heard none of those were really good. And I heard that the one with Matthew McConaughey and Renee Zellweger was not good. So, I've finally just decided to break down and check it out. And it's got a lot of the acting in it is really rough. Like, it does feel like it was put together with very limited resources, that kind of thing.
I mean, I feel like in a way I should watch it, but I also don't feel like, I didn't like I'm find missing it, much.
I mean, if you have the 82 minutes or whatever to spare, you might as well, because it's a classic. But it's not something that, it wasn't nearly as disturbing as I thought it would be. Because, and this was the surprising thing to me, it doesn't really show that much. Most of it's implied. Like, there's nothing, you never see a chainsaw go into a body. You never see flesh being ripped off or anything like that.
Is that because of the director's choices of the filmmaking? Or was it because of the time period that it was in?
Probably a combination of the two, I would say. I did hear that the sequel goes a lot more graphic with the blood and the violence.
What year was that?
1973 was the original, like, I don't know, late 70s, early 80s, I think.
Okay.
Dennis Hopper was in it, apparently. And based on my research, Dennis Hopper and Leatherface have, like, a chainsaw fight towards the end or something.
Oh, that's cool.
I'm assuming it doesn't go very well for Dennis Hopper because Leatherface is in all the other movies. So, just saying. But yeah, no, it was a lot of implied violence. Like, you know, you'd see a hook hanging there. You'd see Leatherface pick somebody up and then, you know, put them on there, but you wouldn't see a hook coming out of a person's body. You'd see her, like, and, like, writhe in pain and stuff, but you wouldn't see any, like, any penetration of blades or anything. Like, there was, you know, it was very, I mean, it's still R-rated because it deserves to be R-rated, but it wasn't like, it was more like the first Saw in that way. in that, you know, people cut, obviously there's a foot cut off at one point in that movie and that kind of thing. But the sequels went way more grotesque with the violence than the original was. It was more about the suspense and the terror, the sheer terror of the situation, rather than, hey, guess what? We're going to throw a bunch of organs at the screen. You know what I mean?
Right. It wasn't gore porn.
Right. Yeah, it wasn't that, which I thought it might be because of the title, because of the reputation, right, how shocking it is, and all that. But no, it was, and give, you know, like I said, some of the acting and everything was off, but I could see why, you know, Toby Hooper's vision was something that, especially like with Halloween back in the 70s, made such an impact where people were like, holy shit, I've never seen anything like this before. And you don't, you know, just kind of imagine what happens when Leatherface slams that metal door. And then, you know, the next thing you know, the last survivor is there, like, with this family of cannibals, and they're eating these, like, random pieces of sausage that you're like, well, they're probably made out of her friends and stuff.
You know what I mean? Movies like Wrong Turn that completely tried to copy the Texas Chainsaw Massacre idea.
I didn't see that either.
But it was set in the Appalachians, and they were...
I heard that the Wrong Turn 2, the straight-to-video one, I actually heard that was good, too.
Oh.
Sometimes there's random straight to, and like I was telling you recently, Curse of Chucky is supposed to be actually a decent movie and probably one of the better ones in that franchise since the original. And I heard it compared to Wrong Turn 2 as like, it's like the best straight to video horror movie since that. And I was like, wow, really?
It was Wrong Turn. The original Wrong Turn wasn't bad, but it just, we were in this, you remember this period in the early 2000s.
Urban legend, blah, blah, blah.
Everything was a...
That was because of Scream.
Yeah.
Scream brought back the slasher movie.
Which clearly was very meta for all these horror movies we were talking about, Halloween. Did they really reference Texas Chainsaw Massacre?
In that? Probably.
Maybe like once or something.
But the whole point was that Psycho. Slasher movies became a big thing with Halloween and Friday the 13th and Nightmare on Elm Street, and then sort of faded over the next decade or so because there were so many imitators of movies trying to be like John Carpenter's, like Wes Craven's, like Toby Hooper's, and they just kind of ran the subgenre into the ground, and then Scream was the one that brought it back out, and then there was Urban Legend and The Final Destination. Like, death was all of a sudden a slasher, like the embodiment of death, remember?
But then horror films kind of disappeared again, and then maybe it was Saw?
Saw was 2004. They didn't disappear that much.
Yeah, but it kind of, I mean, it still wasn't, as, it stopped being as
well,
popular.
Well, you had two dueling subgenres sort of coming to the forefront, I think, in the early 2000s. And I know now we're turning in like a whole dissertation on horror cinema. We're supposed to be talking about Miss Peregrine. But, you know, whatever. We had a conversation about this the other day, and you're like, we should talk about this on the podcast, or you should write about this or something. And I was like,
I think you should write about it. But no, I mean.
Well, we're talking about it now.
But no, that's a really good point, is that we've had all these, like, transitions of horror films.
Well, that's been.
And now we're going back.
But they've been well documented by other film critics and stuff. This is not something that I'm creating.
Well, now we're going back to the Texas Chainsaw Massacre filming and the Halloween filming, where it doesn't give it all the way.
Right.
There's not as much blood.
Well, there's a.
You can now actually have horror films that are rated PG-13 because. And it's also not, they're not making women topless anymore.
For no reason. Yeah. Gratuitous nudity. That was a thing, especially in the 80s.
Yeah.
Well, every horror 70s
movie. 70s and 80s.
Well, yeah. But late 70s, early
80s. And a lot really of teen comedies in the 80s were topless women,
well,
too.
Well, yeah. But then we saw, American Pie was a resurgence of that. But anyway, in the early 2000s, we had sort of the torture, quote unquote, torture porn films spearheaded by Saw and Hostel. And then you had the found footage thing happening in around the same time, a few years later,
and that was too.
Yeah, Japanese American remakes of Japanese horror was another thing that died pretty fairly fast, I feel like,
because what,
in less than a, yeah,
well, I guess because I only really remember The Ring and
Grudge. Well, those were the big ones.
Yeah,
so what happens is like a movie or two comes out and lands with audiences, and then everybody's like, oh, we need to make more of this kind, and then don't, not understanding that you also have to make them good. Can't just be like, oh, we're gonna remake The Eye. Remember that movie, The Eye?
Jessica Alba? Yeah.
That was a remake of a Japanese horror movie, I believe, too.
Oh.
There's a bunch of them like that are really terrible.
And it's not just horror films, they do that with all those types of
movies. Yeah, but Japanese horror specifically was the trend there. And then in the mid-2000s, maybe late 2000s, early 2010s was when we got Paranormal Activity, Cloverfield happened in 2007, and then found footage became a big thing. It still kind of is. I mean, Blair Witch is back.
Blair Witch was the original.
Blair Witch, yeah, I guess. But I feel like, what was that? What came after Blair Witch and before Paranormal Activity that was like found footage that was memorable?
Cloverfield was before Paranormal Activity.
Cloverfield was 2007.
Right.
Paranormal Activity was what, 2009 maybe?
Yes.
Okay.
2009. So I don't remember.
I don't think much. I don't think. Right. Because then the next very next year, they did Book of Shadows, and everybody's like, what the fuck? They got like a lot of Fs and zero stars and like made no money. So I think everybody's like, okay, never mind. See that found footage film we were developing? Let's cancel that.
But yeah, you want to talk about no money needed?
Oh, yeah,
for
seriously.
A movie? Like, goodness.
But yeah, but now we have sort of what I told you, throwback horror, which is basically The Conjuring and The Insidious and Sinister, which movies that feel like they were made in the late 70s, early 80s. They're more restrained. They're more horror. They're more terrifying on an elemental level. Like, there's this demonic force after you. There's this evil spirit thing coming after you. Or, like, this family's being haunted. They're like, you know what I mean? They feel like Amityville, Poltergeist, that kind of movie, rather than, you know, found footage. They don't really fit with any of the other trends that are going on right now.
Right, and I guess it makes it better. But here's the thing, though, is that
and they're also not remakes. That's the other thing. They're also not remakes of all these other horror movies that we've mentioned, because all the ones, the classic ones we've just been talking about, they've all been remade. Most of them unsuccessfully. Go ahead.
Well, so the difference, though, with The Insidious and The Conjuring, to be like more of a throwback to the Amityville and the Poltergeist, is that those are dealing with supernatural beings compared to these films like Texas Chainsaw Massacre, Halloween. Those are realistic monsters that I wonder if we're going to see that again with a realistic monster that's shot in the same way. That's not going to be a slasher film.
Don't Breathe is sort of a thriller slash horror film about a man.
Oh, okay.
Kind of terrorizing a group of kids, sort of. I won't get into that movie so much because I already have a podcast talking about my review of that, but definitely check that out when you can. It's too bad that's not out on DVD in time for Halloween.
That wasn't smart of them, was it?
Well, I mean, they came out, what, August? Late August? September, early September or something?
Yeah. They should time these movies better. Like, even Lights Out's not going to be out in time for Halloween.
Yeah, but this was a great summer for horror. And even the Purge movies, which I haven't really even seen, but from what I'm aware of, it sounds like they're very much in that, like, 80s... like John Carpenter B movie type style of something like Escape from New York, or you know what I mean? So yeah, so throwback horror seems to be the thing now, which I'm fine with. I'm liking most of these horror movies.
We don't need the gore, you know.
Unless it serves the story, then I'm fine with. Well, I also saw today on Twitter that they are officially starting production on Saw Legacy, so they're bringing another one of those, and I'm like, oh man, please don't. That last one was rough. Like, I'm not a defender of the Saw franchise, but that first one is really strong, and that, ironically, the sixth one is really strong. I really like the sixth one. But seven, it did not end on a strong note, so I don't know where they're going to go with it now, but I don't know if I care to find out.
That's not James Wan, though, is it?
James Wan created it. He did the original, yes.
Oh.
That's what I'm saying. James Wan is basically our modern Wes Craven or one of those.
R.I.P.
I know, R.I.P. Wes Craven. But James Wan is sort of leading that new generation of like cutting edge horror directors right now.
That's cool.
Fede Alvarez, I think he's Mexican. The Mexican director, I'm not sure. I should double check on that before I put my foot in my mouth. But the director of Evil Dead and Don't Breathe, he's also another one of those. Oh, he's from Uruguay. Okay, it's good. I'm glad I checked. Fede Alvarez, the director from Uruguay, who did Evil Dead and Don't Breathe, he's another one that's sort of on the cutting edge of this, you know, kind of thing. And it's interesting, too, because he's also teeters on the edge between Evil Dead, which was his remake of Evil Dead. Again, I said these all have been remade, or rebooted, rather, because there's no Ash in it. That film was really embracing of blood and gore and splatter and, like, crazy shit happening. But then Don't Breathe is way more restrained, and there's towards the end, there's a couple like moments where you're like, oh, what the fuck? But there's not a lot of that throughout. It's more about suspense and about nobody make noise, and you know, so he's already demonstrated sort of an interesting versatility within that, where he's not just kind of centering on one approach to the genre.
Well, what about Blumhouse?
Blumhouse? Well, that's a production company.
But they're working with James Wan a lot.
All the franchises that we already mentioned of, the Insidious and Sinister and The Conjuring and all that. See? And see. Insidious, the Purge movies they do.
Oh, wow. They're doing Sharp Objects, too?
Yeah, exactly. The Visit, Sinister, The Gift.
Oh, that's right. The gift was a great scary movie, which wasn't really supposed to be scary. It was more Hitchcockian.
I'd say
psychological thriller
than anything. Yeah, Ouija, Whiplash. Even they've done all kinds of movies, but the Paranormal Activity. But they're known mostly for they've done a lot of the most recent notable horror films, or at least the ones that have landed in the box office. So it's an interesting time for horror, especially this summer was specifically strong with Don't Breathe, The Conjuring, and Purge, and Lights Out, and Shallows, which we still have to see. That's out now, so we need to check that out.
Yeah, we do. Well, one other movie we watched, because we started the Halloween trend early this year, we also watched Creepshow 2, which neither of us had seen.
Yeah, that's not too strong.
And that was not good.
For the ride, lady.
Yeah, that was...
was the best part.
Creepshow is, I think, is pretty fun and pretty good. But yeah, Creepshow 2 was not enjoyable.
Yeah. Well, it's fun that we, it seems like we're so far kind of a little more focused on watching Halloween movies and scary films than we have been in the past. Because usually we just put on like, oh, let's watch Dracula Den Loving It, or let's watch...
We could still do that too.
Return to Oz or something. But it seems like this year we're trying to make a little more effort to like, no, you know what? Let's watch this like classic one that we've never seen before, that kind of thing. And, you're going to show me Christine, which I've never seen.
Right. I don't know if that's a classic.
It's got a cult following though. And it's, it was also George Romero. Who was it? John Carpenter. Yeah.
Yeah.
John Carpenter's made some pretty interesting movies. He's got a pretty good track record. Depending on who you ask. I don't know. We tried to watch Big Little Trouble in Little China, and I don't know. I think I was too tired, or was like not in the vibe of exactly just how weird that movie was trying to be.
Yeah, I loved that movie when I was little, but watched it again, and I was like, oh my, when I was older, I was like, wow.
But he doesn't. It's very purposeful that it's being ridiculous. It's just whether or not that works for you, I guess. And I don't think I watched it at the right time. I was not, I don't know. I wasn't braced myself for that level of craziness, I guess. So we'll report back with further horror films as the month goes on, hopefully. And if I can convince Kai to do it, we'll be doing a crooked commentary, our second ever, on The Nightmare Before Christmas, which is not that long of a film. So it's like 80 minutes. You can make it through that.
What about the crooked commentary on Scott Pilgrim?
Yeah, we'll do that too. But I feel like Nightmare Before Christmas is more timely with October. So
right.
Scott Pilgrim I can do whenever. But yes, I love Scott Pilgrim vs. the World, and Kai does not, so that would be an interesting conversation. Not that you hate it, but you don't like it very much, I guess, is the point.
Oh my gosh, I just wonder what's going to happen to me, like happen to you, where if I watch it a second time, like you did, I'm like, oh my gosh, you know what? This movie is great.
Maybe you'll appreciate it a little better. The first time I saw it, I was like, this movie's weird. I don't know. I got to let this marinate a little bit. And then I don't even know what made me watch it a second time. But I watched it a second time and was like, oh my God, I love this. And then now it's just like so ingrained in my mind that I quote it on a regular basis. 2 hours! I just say all kinds of random stuff.
You do.
The acoustics in here are amazing! Pretty, especially Jason Schwartzman, I guess. He's got some great lines, like the ultimate hipster. But that'll be another time. So I think what we'll just jump right into now is our review of Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children. So this is the new film from Tim Burton, and it stars Eva Green, Asa Butterfield, Samuel L. Jackson, Chris O'Dowd, and a bunch of kids that I don't know their names because they're not big stars. And based on this movie, they probably won't really become one, I'm just saying. Not that they're bad in it, but I don't know. I wasn't impressed with anything by them.
You liked the blonde girl thing named Ella?
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah.
She was fine, I guess. She was whatever. Since you read the book, do you want to give us first of all, just explain in general what the hell the story's about? Because I saw it and I'm still not sure.
Okay, and it's also, maybe these things will be answered with additional movies, which I read that actually Tim Burton he may very well not be doing the sequels.
Usually he doesn't.
He spoke about that. He's like, I got it started.
I've created the world. I'm bored now.
Right. He's not
a sequel. He's never done a sequel except for Batman Returns. And honestly, I feel like if he could do it again, he'd probably be like, yeah, I don't want to do another one of these.
But he probably liked the money.
Well, yeah, the money. That's probably why he did it. But
yeah. But, okay. So the book, the story is about a boy, Jake, who, he's very close with his grandfather, and yet his grandfather is not really very close to Jake's dad, and everyone basically thinks he's suffering from, his grandfather's suffering from dementia because he's talking about these monsters, and no one is seeing these monsters. And in the beginning of the movie, Jake goes to go help his grandfather, and his grandfather is dead. But basically the grandfather requests that Jake go to Cairnhelm to go find Miss Peregrine. And it's told a little bit differently in the book. This was more found out through a letter that Jake got from his grandfather for his birthday. But anyway, so basically Jake goes to...
You don't have to give everybody the whole story. I said set it up, the premise. You don't have to like... You're doing a book report on it now. What the heck?
Oh, yeah, book reports. Yeah, no, but... Well, so, okay, so he just goes to... he goes
to
visit...
To find out the truth.
Yeah, he goes to England essentially to find out the truth, right? Okay. What happened, and to see if his grandfather really was telling the truth. And he goes into an interesting land, and I think...
Well, we should say we're probably going to get into spoilers.
Yes.
For Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children from this point on. I mean, we're just, you know, set it up for you. And then, you know, if you're going to check out the film, go see it and then listen to this. If you're not going to see it, that's probably a smart decision. So continue listening. Based on my perspective, it seems like it's getting very mixed reviews. Where it's got, what did I tell you, 63% on Rotten Tomatoes, which is technically fresh, but also so close to not being fresh that it's not
rotten.
That it's not really one that I would be like, there's a consensus, people like it. I'm like, no, not really. It's kind of half and half, basically. And I, you know, it's pretty obvious which half I fell on with this.
Yes.
So having read the book and going to see the movie, what did you think of, well, first of all, you liked the book, right? More or less?
Yeah, more or less I did.
But you're kind of at that point now where you're just like me with movies. You're like, I'll read anything, whatever.
Well, it's also because I knew this movie was coming out, and...
And you're one of those, I have to read the book
before I
see
the movie. Plus, I wanted to give fantasy a try. Honestly, I've never really read a fantasy book before.
Should have read a Harry Potter.
I didn't read Harry Potter.
You would have been better off with Harry Potter, because at least, you know, those stories are better.
Well, the thing is that I found really amazing about this story is that the author built the story around photographs. And throughout the book... the book is littered with photographs, and they're legitimate photographs of pictures that he found at flea markets, pictures that other people found, and he just built story. He built a story around them, and he actually did the same thing with the second and the third book, and he's even said that he even has more photographs that he would like to use. The author is also used to be a resident of Florida, so that's exciting. Like, not even just Florida, Tampa Bay, where Robert and I live. He used to live here, but now he's in LA being a big time writer. But I think that's pretty incredible. And when I was reading the book, I mean, I never even read Harry Potter, but I have seen all the films. Thank you, Rob.
You're welcome.
Seem reminiscent of Harry Potter, but more gothy, more gothic Harry Potter, and a little scarier, a little edgier. I do consider it more of a young adult story, maybe even a little bit, maybe not, I wouldn't even say not tween age, maybe like 15, because in the book at least there are some kind of gross things that happen that I don't know if necessarily young kids should be reading about,
so having read the book, that was a long answer to did you like the book. Jeez, you're like Kevin Smith with answers these days. I'm like, here's the question, blah, blah, blah. You're like 45 minutes later. Oh, I'm sorry. Did you have anything to add?
No, the thing is, I liked the book okay. Uh-huh. I actually didn't like the ending of the book. The ending of the book was sort of boring to me. And I really appreciated what Tim Burton did with the ending. Like, he took some creative liberties.
Okay, can we make a logical progression with this conversation? You're just like, the book is okay, but let me tell you about the ending. I'm like, whoa,
I'm not gonna tell you about the ending.
I know, but you seem like you were worried you were going to. Okay, so having read the book and then seen the movie, what did you like about the movie? Because you seem to like it a little bit more than me. Because I honestly, I've told you this earlier, but I would give this probably a 2.5 out of 5. I did not really care for anything about it other than Eva Green, but that's not because of the material. That's just because she just has a presence about her, and she was kind of a weird, quirky, almost quasi Mary Poppins-esque character, and I love me some Mary Poppins. But so I would I wish she was in this film more, because she would have saved it from being boring. In my opinion, obviously, if people enjoy this movie, then I'm glad. Congratulations, but you know you might be wrong. Just saying. No, I'm playing. It's fine. Go ahead. So go ahead. So
what I like about it?
Did you like? Convince me why it's good. Basically, is my thing.
I didn't say it was good though either. I said it was okay. I said,
She's speechless because she's like, there's no defense for this.
What I thought was good about it was interesting the way that, I don't know, like, I don't think it's been done before where you have someone go into, here's a spoiler, it goes into a time loop. Okay. And they're in the same, and they know that they're in the same day all the time.
Okay, continue.
It's similar to Groundhog Day in that fact, but the thing is in this world, everybody knows they're in the same day over and over and over again. And they're trying they're hiding out in these time loop to get away from monsters. And I just thought that's just a really interesting storytelling perspective. And when I found out that twist, I thought that was pretty cool.
But what did they do about it? What did they do with it? They didn't do anything interesting with it. Except, oh, look, there's the bomb that's going to blow up the school. And then we loop back around and look, it's okay. Let's go back inside. That's all they did. There was one sequence where that was interesting. The rest of it could have not even been in a time loop, and it would have been the exact same story.
Well, right, but what was it about the time loop? But why would it be different with them being in time loop? Like, how would they have made that different if they're living, basically reliving the same day?
There was nothing about that conversation, about that aspect of the story that was interesting or well executed or explored particularly well. It was just sort of, yeah, we're in a time loop, whatever, and that was it. It was just a part of the setting. It didn't function into the story in any kind of meaningful way. He might as well have been walking into freaking Narnia, but it's like, oh, it's a time loop, it's 1943 instead of the land of Narnia or, you know, freaking Hogwarts or whatever. It had no bearing on anything. They didn't do anything particularly interesting with it.
Okay, I guess that's right. I mean, because if we talk about reliving the same day over and over again, Groundhog Day really got that right.
Right.
But, you know, that was magical filmmaking.
And it was a comedy. It's a different type of genre.
Right. But these kids knew they were in a time loop. They knew that they were in their late 80s.
Right.
Even in their 90s. And Miss Peregrine's whole power was being able to manipulate time, and she was the only one that could do it.
Even though it looked like it was more her little stopwatch that did the work than her. She didn't do a spell, or she didn't like chant or close her eyes and concentrate or something. So it looked like it was her little watch. So basically anybody that has a little watch should be able to do it, according to the movie.
That was Tim Burton's creative liberty, because they did not do that in the book.
Well, that cheapens her, what's supposed to be her peculiarity, which is such a weird word. But it's also in
filmmaking, how do you tell that? How do you show that?
I don't know. Have her say some words or read something or sit there and meditate while things go in reverse or something. There's other ways to do that. By showing her doing it with a little thing, and she might as well have been like, got knocked out of the way by Hermione Granger with a time turner. Same thing.
And yeah, and in the book, I don't think they went outside every single night to watch her, you know, turn the stopwatch.
That was kind of a memorable sequence. The only one in the movie. That's why I called that out specifically a minute ago.
Right. But yeah, I mean, I don't know. I thought the time loop piece of it was interesting.
It would.
And I do think that visually it was interesting, but
it had potential to be interesting, but in my opinion, wasn't. Go ahead.
It's like we talked about before after the movie, is that it was very perfect for Tim Burton. And I think, and he did make some changes to the film compared to the book that part of me didn't really understand, but I also get that he did that for cinematic reasons. He changed some of the characters' peculiarities, and that actually has upset some viewers.
Oh, some hardcore people. They're like, you messed it up.
And I'm not a hardcore person.
Right. So. I mean, you read it, but you're like, I can see that. It's whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm usually a hater of film, by the way, compared to the book.
There are people that they read a book and they watch a movie and it doesn't have every line of dialogue, every moment, every character, every exactly as they were in the book. People lose their shit. Not understanding that in a book you have hundreds of pages to get into people's heads, to develop things more, to have multiple subplots and blah, 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 blah. Whereas in a movie you only have 2 hours. Unless they do what the other thing that people hate that they do, and they make multiple movies out of one book. And then people are like, oh, you just stretch the story out, blah, blah, blah. Some of that. So that's it's a lose-lose scenario, basically.
Right, but it seems like that was really only necessary with Harry Potter.
Split in half?
Yeah, because that does seem like that made a lot of the readers of the books happy. Because there was so much to tell.
Well, because you haven't read the Harry Potter books, but maybe I can work on that and getting you to read those next. Because ask your sister, she loves the Harry Potter books. Those are well developed, and most of the other books, like the first three of the Harry Potter books, are not particularly long. You've seen them. They're like maybe 300 pages. They're like more like what you would read if you were in like, I don't know, third grade and you're reading a book in school or something. They're about that length. When you get to the latter half, 4, 5, 6, 7, then they start to get like 800 pages and shit like that. But there's a lot of subplots and a lot of things going on that don't really have anything to do with the main story. So like, I think I don't remember which one it is. I want to say Goblet of Fire. There's a whole subplot about Hermione is like, well, we got to free the house elves and blah, 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 blah. That has nothing to do with the Triwizard Tournament, with everything that's going on with Harry, with Voldemort, with the grand scheme of things. That's just a world building subplot to just be like, and then this was happening too, you know, to sort of just develop out what the Wizarding World is all about. In the seventh one, they stripped all that shit away because this was the last one, so they had to kind of wrap everything up. So pretty much every chapter, from what I understand, that's the only one I haven't read, actually. Every chapter pretty much is about Voldemort, Harry, and then the search for the Horcruxes, and, you know, trying to basically defeat the Dark Lord once and for all, which is why you sort of needed two movies. And you've seen both of those movies, even though the first one is a lot slower and it's more about setup. There's no way you could have done that story and strip all that out, because it's just, how would you even do that? You know? So I don't know. My whole thing is that this movie just feels super derivative. And yes, it is too perfect for Tim Burton. It's like Tim Burton almost could have made the story up himself and brought it to the screen, and it would have been pretty much exactly the same. It just feels really derivative. It's like if you take Harry Potter and you take X-Men and you mix them together and you take away all the personality, that's what you have. Because Asa Butterfield, who is a good actor in movies like Hugo, which I love, that's a 5-star movie for me. He's really flat in this. He had no personality, and his character was just like, well, this is crazy. What's going on? Like, really, and his American accent threw me off because he's not particularly good at it, and he enunciates everything too much because he's like, I'm using a different accent. We have to do this and say Miss Peregrine, and then the movie just basically insults the intelligence of the viewers, I guess because it's made also to appeal to kids, which, by the way, if it's dark like you're saying and not for kids, why are they treating it like a kids movie? You see what I'm saying? It's like a movie that doesn't know what it wants to be or who it wants to be for. So it's trying to be all of it and kind of failing across the board for me. Where in the movie, they're all like, oh, we have to go over here to stop the time loop because the Hollows are going to blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, I know, I get it. I've been watching. I understand. Why are you telling me this? Just do it already, dude. And nothing really, 2/3 of the movie, they go back and forth between, oh, look at this crazy place. Oh, we all have this weird power. It's crazy. I'm going to go back here and sit on the beach with my dad for 5 minutes. I'm like, why are you doing this? There's no progression. It just goes flip-flops back and forth. It's like channel surfing. It's like, do I want to watch the game? Oh, this is beauty pageants on. Oh, look, the news is happening. Oh, this crazy shit. What is this? It's like, no, you're not telling a story. You're not focusing on something and developing from point A to point B to point C all the way to a satisfying finale. You're just going back and forth hoping like, oh, has it been 2 hours yet? Okay, great finale. Let's hit the switch and get the climax.
Like that too.
That's
like,
annoying.
That sometimes I did lose my focus.
Well, then bad adaptation. That's a bad adaptation of a book to film. If you're going to, it did not work for me basically at all. And the more we're talking about it, the more I'm kind of pissed. This is sort of,
you mentioned that it was similar to
the Sully conversation where I was like, I didn't realize I hated this movie so much until right now.
But you mentioned it was similar to X-Men. You're talking about Days of Future Past?
No, I'm talking about a house, a school full of special children who all have abilities. X-Men.
Oh, right.
Not because of the pacing or anything. Not that. And not because of the time travel. I'm saying because it's, we all have powers and we have this older mentor person who takes care of us. That's why. It feels like that, but it's also Harry Potter, and then they're all little kids. And it's a destiny, and this kid is meant for this world, or whatever. Like, the self, Harry Potter, in that it has a male protagonist who is, you know, he's actually a teenager, not a child, but close enough, who is discovering this magical world that he's been a part of, but not even realizing it his whole life. And X-Men, in that it's a school full of special children who live in this house for their own safety and are misunderstood by the outside world and have other people who have similar abilities chasing them down and wreaking havoc on shit that they have to stop. That sounds like X-Men and Harry Potter to me.
That's actually a very good point.
I'd rather go home and watch X-Men and Harry Potter, honestly. There was nothing about this movie that was superior to either one of those franchises. So if they make a sequel, they don't make a sequel, I kind of don't give a shit. Even Samuel L. Jackson, who was a great actor and a lot of fun to watch in movies, was really, he just felt out of place here. He felt, he shows up and he's hamming it up, and that's great, and I enjoy Samuel L. Jackson hamming things up, but it did not fit with the tone of this movie.
Well, he's also a character that got put in the film for absolutely no reason, other than Tim Burton even said, the reason that Samuel L. Jackson's in this movie is because I've always wanted to work with Samuel L. Jackson.
Yeah, but I mean, you could have cast anybody else in that part, too. It's not him in the part, it's the performance style that he was, I guess, that he was probably directed to take.
Right.
By Tim Burton.
Right, because that was not
Did you hear the Tim Burton character? Did you hear that there's a lot of controversy right now with Tim Burton?
No.
And diversity, and he said some stuff about diversity, and he's like, oh, well, it's, you know, it's like if I watch a blaxploitation movie, I'm not going to be like, well, why aren't there more white people in this? So maybe basically people are saying, why aren't there more black people in your movies in general? And he didn't particularly handle that answer very well. Even though, I mean, I understand they're like in what, Wales or wherever the hell they're supposed to be in this movie.
There's black people in England.
Right. So I think his defense was, oh, you know, there's not really anybody in the story and blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, you can also go out here. Well, yeah, Harry Potter is in England and there's black people in Hogwarts. I mean, they're not the main character.
As well.
Right, exactly. So he did not handle that answer. I mean, I'm sure he didn't mean anything specifically by it.
And wasn't his ex-wife English? Isn't she English? Helen Bonham Carter?
Well, yeah, but I'm not saying that.
She could have shared some of her.
I'm sure he didn't mean anything by it, but it's also like if you're in this position of power and you're casting a movie with such a. I even thought about that during the movie while we were watching. I'm like, Jesus Christ, there's a lot of little white kids in this movie. And I was a little white kid, so I'm like, okay, yeah, white kids, I guess. But if you're going to have such a big cast of like, what, there's like 10 of these freaking kids that are in the school or whatever. Or home, that's not even school, but it's a home, whatever, same difference. Yeah, that's another point. Do they go to school? Do they not learn anything? These kids are going to be stupid forever, but they're never going to age, I guess, so it doesn't matter.
No, I don't think they've learned anything.
Where was I going with this? Oh, you couldn't have cast any of those people with Asians or Hispanics or black people or anything? They're just like, yeah, no, all white people.
Well, does that have anything to do... It might have something to do with the time period. It was set in 1943.
I guess, but...
Diversity wasn't really a very big thing in 1943.
Yeah, because this movie's really striving for realism. Come on. That's bullshit. He should have had a little more diversity in there, at least to mix it up. That's... Say what you want about franchises like Fast and Furious or... The Avengers is a bad example. Well, at least they have a lot of black people.
The Expendables.
I don't know. At least these franchise movies that have that are run by an ensemble... At least some of them actually make an effort to have diversity. So, and I appreciate that. But that was not the cause of the issues in this movie. It just didn't help. I just didn't know if you knew about that controversy.
I did not know about that. Yeah. It's pretty...
I've been hearing about it on Twitter. People are getting Twitter arguments over this whole thing.
Like that they don't... That they...
No, that he was justified in not putting black people in it. Or that it's an insensitive whatever. I don't know. Regardless, he didn't handle the question very well. You should, after we're done here, search out, see what he said about it, because he didn't answer that the way you're supposed to answer that, regardless of whether or not he did it on purpose or not. Maybe he didn't even think of that, because, you know, he's a white man too, so maybe he didn't, like, oh, white people, right? That's what we do. But it's a little weird that the only person in the movie that's black is the bad guy.
Right.
Too, which also doesn't really look very good for him. I guess. But anyway, back to Samuel L. Jackson. It's not that he's bad. It's that his performance style is so hammy and over the top, and the rest of the movie isn't over the top in that same way. It's over the top, and it's like, look at this crazy imagery. These twins that do this whatever. This little girl that's like gets all like, is it just me or did her face change when she pushed stuff?
What girl?
The strong girl who's like, her face looked contorted.
Face did change, yeah.
Yeah, okay. And then like the girl with the teeth in the back of her head, things like that. It was strange in like an Addams Family kind of bizarre way. Not in a like, ooh, you really need a mint. Like Samuel Jackson making jokes and being like all like so big. I didn't think it really fit the tone of the movie. And I get that he's the villain and therefore he should have a different sensibility about him than everybody else. But maybe that's the problem. Maybe in the movie they felt like, all right, so these are the good guys, so they should all just be really bland. And then the bad guy will be like really interesting and like loud and like, oh, Mr., you know, whatever your fucking name is. Oh man, they don't tell us the last name. And he's just like, oh, Miss Peregrine, blah, blah, blah. And he's like, oh, really big and stuff. I don't know. He just felt really either miscast or misdirected by Tim Burton, or Tim Burton needed to rein him in or something. Because it did that just made the movie feel silly. And any stakes that the movie had, as soon as he started running around making jokes, I was just like, okay, now I don't even give a shit. At any moment in this movie, if I was taking this seriously and going to be worried about these kids, now I don't even care anymore. Because now you just made it a comedy. And it wasn't supposed to be. I didn't think it was till that point. Although considering that it's like 2 hours and I feel like I wasted my time, and maybe I should be thankful that at least a few moments were kind of funny. I'm like, Sam Jackson with crazy eyes and weird hair.
And Tim Burton did get his wish. He did get Samuel Jackson in a movie.
I guess. But I mean, Samuel Jackson will take so many scripts. I mean, I'm sure he could have worked with them on another film.
I know.
But and again, it's not. Samuel Jackson is a very versatile actor. He could have dialed it down had he been directed. I mean, look at Star Wars. Samuel Jackson's a great actor, but not in Star Wars. He's like, a Sith Lord? Wait here, Anakin. I will go talk to the Supreme Chancellor. It's like he's reading cue cards during the whole movie, basically.
And he wanted to be in that movie.
But that's not his bad, because everybody, Oscar winner Natalie Portman, is like that. We'd be living a lie. I couldn't do that. Could you, Anakin? Could you live like that? I'm like, what the fuck? Oscar winner Natalie Portman? Jesus Christ.
Well, she was an Oscar winner.
No, yet. Not then, but she was still...
She should be so lucky she became
She was still
one.
Capable. She was still capable. Look at The Professional, 1994, I think. She's great in that. She's freaking 12 years old in that movie. What the hell? So it's clearly the direction. I'm going to say it's probably the direction Sam Jackson was given. Or he was just reading the script. He's like, oh, this is terrible. I need to like keep myself from getting bored on set. And then he did this. This is what we ended up with. Whatever. Anyway, he didn't fit in this movie. The only character in this movie that was interesting to me was Miss Peregrine. And that's because she nailed the tone of being like weird and quirky, but also sort of subdued and classy and very British. And like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
She nailed it. I would want to see him. It's weird this movie's called Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children. And Miss Peregrine's the most interesting character, but Miss Peregrine's also not in like 2/3 of the footage. How much is her screen time? She's like, this is like Beetlejuice level screen time. Beetlejuice, who's in the movie Beetlejuice, less than everyone else in the movie Beetlejuice. Which is why whenever...
Tim Burton likes to do that, doesn't he?
I guess so. Which is why whenever Beetlejuice shows up, you're like, oh, right, here we go. This guy's got much better. Not that it's bad without him, but the Michael Keaton scenes of Beetlejuice. The Michael Keaton scenes of Beetlejuice are by far the standout moments of that film. And I guess, you know, maybe by making everything around her so blah, he makes Miss Peregrine come off even better as a result. I'm not sure.
Well, I think it's also Tim Burton has also lost his magic.
For sure.
He lost it a long time ago.
Long time ago. The only last movie I loved by him was Sweeney Todd. Yeah, Sweeney Todd. Oh, we should watch that this month. It's a great movie. And he didn't even really, I mean, that was his vision of a film, but it was based on the play. And there were changes that were made and stuff, but the music and everything was already sort of there to be plucked out and rearranged. Plus Johnny Depp, when he was still caring about giving good performances. Which, again, he probably hasn't done since then, I think, too. I think that movie just, like, they're like, and I'm spent. That's all we got. We're just going to keep making movies for another decade that nobody needs to see.
Yeah, they just decided to be barbers. It's, you know, all the creativity came out from the blood of
them. Yeah, Johnny Depp and Tim Burton just, like, slit the throat of their careers. They're like, oh, this is it. So, yes. Any other thoughts?
I'm not going to say it's a great film. It's
good.
Not,
so you're not going to lie to people.
But I'm not going to say it's a bad film either. And I do see why Tim Burton took the creative licenses that he did with this film. And I think it was interesting in its own way, but I do agree that, yeah, it was derivative of other things. I didn't even think about the X-Men angle, actually. I was thinking more
about
it.
How do you not?
Because I just didn't think about
They're almost like, out. I have expected Professor X to come around and be like, Jake, I'd like to introduce you to the rest of my students. I don't know why that sounded like Sean Connery.
And I don't know why either. But the Harry Potter angle, definitely.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's kind of hard not to see it. They're both based on books and everything, too. I mean, X-Men is, too, but those are comic books. It's a little different.
It's also hard now to make a fantasy film without it being similar to Harry Potter, because Harry Potter has such a pop culture resonance that and has affected so many people.
Yeah, but if it had similarities to Harry Potter and X-Men, but then it did something new and interesting and added something to that, then I'd be like, it's amazing. It's like Harry Potter meets X-Men. It's awesome. But no, they took both and they were like, we're going to do both of these, only Terrible. And I was like, why? We already have X-Men The Last Stand. We've already seen Terrible X-Men. You don't have to do that to us.
And also, don't forget, it's also similar to Groundhog Day.
I guess. But that's been done. Time loops have been done in movies before. I can't think of any off the top of my head, but they have. It's not a new concept that Miss Peregrine's like rolling with for the first time.
Okay.
So, fair enough. Any final thoughts you would recommend people to go see? What would you give it out of 5? I think you gave it 3 on Letterboxd.
I think I gave it 3.
Okay. Yeah. So she says 3, I say 2.5. She's a little nicer than I am in this movie review and in life, apparently. So mild recommendation from Kai, a non-recommendation from Rob. But you know what? I just wrote the 10 movies we're looking forward to for October for Screen Rant, and there's not really much out there coming out for families in the next few weeks. So if you have little kids and you want to take them to see something that at least has Samuel Jackson yelling stuff in it to keep you from like falling asleep in your popcorn, this might be your last chance for a while, because the only kids movies coming out are Middle School, The Worst Years of My Life, which I think is based on a series of books.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know if anybody cares about that movie, so I don't know if anybody will go see it. And Max Steel, which looks terrible from what I've heard. And yeah, so I don't expect either of those to do any kind of substantive business this month. But then you have November, and you have, you know, this November and December, and then you have Rogue One, you have Doctor Strange, you have Moana, you have Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them, you have Trolls, and there's a lot of other kids' family movies coming out.
When does Sing come out? Next summer?
Oh, no. Sing. Soon, this fall, too. All of those are in the November, December. But October, it's like a dead zone for family entertainment.
Wasn't October similar to January?
No, usually that's September, but I feel like September was actually a little more interesting this year than normally. Because, I mean, you still had Sully, you still had Blair Witch, you still had, not that I liked Blair Witch, but it was like a movie that people were talking about. Peregrine, and there was another one. Oh, man, Magnificent Seven. So you had a few that were more mainstream, like blockbustery type movies out there. But so yeah, that's Miss Peregrine. That's all we have to say about it. We think maybe next episode. And apologize for missing the last couple weeks. I've been insanely busy with stuff. But I think that's all we have for this episode. Maybe next time I can get Kai on to do the Nightmare Before Christmas.
I think so.
Maybe in the next
week? I'll be a good sport.
In the next week or so, we'll do that and put it up?
I'll be a good sport.
Okay. It's like an 80-minute long movie. It might be 70-something
minutes.
No, but
I've seen it already.
But we'll mute it so that we don't get sued, and we'll talk about it on the podcast.
Okay.
So you can be like, I don't like this Jack Skellington. Why he got to make trouble for people in Christmas Town? And I'll be like, that's mean. He doesn't know any better. And then I can like try not to sing while we're watching it.
Yes, you could try not to sing.
I am the clown with a tearaway face.
Most for me, and also for the listeners.
Aww, that's
you know,
mean.
You have a great voice.
Yeah, I was doing it the other day, and you thought it was super
funny. You have a great voice, but sometimes people don't want to hear singing.
That's a separate podcast. I could do a separate podcast where I just sing the soundtrack to Nightmare Before Christmas.
Oh, there you go.
There you go. Tweet at Crooked Table. You can reach actually. That's a good segue. You can reach me at Crooked Table on Twitter.
You can reach me at The Vault Key LLC on Twitter.
Let us know how much you want to hear an episode where I just sing songs from Nightmare Before Christmas. You could also find more about the more. And now I'm like stumbling over my words because now I'm thinking about how would I do that? That would be fun. What order would I sing them in? The order of the film? Order would I count down my favorite?
Should do a shuffle. That would be fun.
Shuffle and be like, I don't know what song's coming up next. Making Christmas. You could also find more podcasts. videos, reviews, and other movie-related goodies at crookedtable.com. Facebook, Snapchat, what's the other one? Tumblr. We're on all the social media networks.
And Instagram, too.
Oh, Instagram. Yeah, I forgot Instagram. Thank you. I'm on all of those. Either search Crooked Table or my handle is at Crooked Table. We'll be coming back probably about a week with the next episode. I'm going to try and stick to that this month. I promise. You know, if you guys knew how much I have going on, you would forgive me.
It's a true story.
True story.
He sometimes doesn't sleep.
Yeah, sometimes I don't sleep because I'm just trying to make podcasts for you people. Appreciate me. I need your validation, apparently. So as for now, I'm Rob.
And I'm Kai.
And that'll be it for the Crooked Table Podcast. We'll see you next time. Roll credits.
This has been a production of CrookedTable.com. All rights reserved.
That's the art of the low-K-E-D.